Hello friends, let us learn about a new topic today in the kidney, which are most commonly seen in pediatric textbooks, and this is also given in Harrison, in fact. So this comes under pediatrics because in OP guy these disorders are given, but I am completely dealing with from Harrison. So in this lecture we will learn about the hereditary disorders of sodium, potassium or magnesium without hypertension. There is no hypertension, but there are disorders of sodium and potassium and magnesium handling without hypertension. So here they all these are inherited. So in inherited forms there is genetic mutations. So these genetic mutations occurs in various ion transporters. So whenever there is genetic mutations of various ion transporters and channels of ascending, of thick ascending limb of loop of Henry, or and distal convoluted tubule, then we classify them under these conditions. So first let us learn about one condition in this lecture, and I will teach about the other conditions in my next lecture, each condition in each one lecture. The first condition is Bartter's syndrome, and gitelman syndrome. So first we will learn about the Bartter syndrome, and then we will learn about the gitelman syndrome simultaneously. So first about Bartter syndrome. So first pathogenesis and genetics. So Bartter syndrome is of 5 types. Okay. So what are they? So these 5 types are affecting the ion transporter proteins. Ion transporter proteins. All these 5 types are affecting the ion transporter proteins, which are there in the ascending limb of loop of Henle. Ascending limb of loop of Henle. So I'll draw a diagram, and also I'll mention them, each of them separately, so that it becomes easier. So first let me mention it so that I can draw the diagram. So it is basically of 5 types. So in type 1, all these are mutations. So mutations are present in type 1, that is apical loop, diuretic, sensitive, sodium potassium chloride co-transporter mutation. So this is co-transporter mutation, which is NKCl2, which is sodium potassium 2 chloride co-transporter. 2 is here, 2 chloride co-transporter. There is this mutation. Okay, so whenever there is mutation of NKCl, so normally if I'll draw a diagram of showing this, so I'll draw each and every one a diagram separately so that it becomes easier. Normally this is sodium potassium chloride 2 co-transporter. This will allow the sodium potassium 2 chloride and sodium into the cells. It would allow potassium 2 chloride and sodium into the cells. Here there is mutation in this. okay, because there is mutation in this. So this is blood, this is lumen. So this sodium potassium chloride 2-chloride cotransporter, this helps in reabsorption of sodium potassium and 2-chloride, right? So whenever there is mutation in sodium potassium chloride 2-chloride cotransporter, then there is no reabsorption of sodium potassium and 2-chloride. So there is excretion leading to sodium chloride wasting. Okay, so this is what is seen. Now let us learn what happens in type 2. In type 2 Bartter syndrome, it is due to apical potassium channel renal outer medullary, apical potassium channel or renal outer medullary potassium channel mutation. It is called ROMK channel, which is renal outer medullary potassium channel. So where is this Bartter's type 2? What does this do? If this is the thing, so here there is the channel here. So this channel will allow, here there is lumen, here there is blood. So this allows secretion of potassium normally, right? So apical potassium channel, that is renal outer medullary potassium channel mutation. So here there is ROMK normally causes secretion of potassium into the lumen. Thus, whenever there is renal outer medullary potassium channel mutation, then there is no secretion of potassium into the lumen. Okay, this is the thing which is seen. Then, the third type is type 3. In type 3, you have bilateral chloride channel mutation, which is called as chloride channel KB mutation. So this is called chloride channel KB. Okay, so what is the, where is this seen? So here if you see, here this is the scene. This is bilateral chloride channel. So it is seen on the blood surface, on the surface which is towards the blood. So here there is chloride will enter here. So this is chloride channel KB. So normally chloride channel KB, it normally causes, this is lumen, this is blood, it normally causes reabsorption of chloride into the blood. So here whenever there is mutation of chloride channel KB, then there is no reabsorption of chloride into the blood. So there is chloride secretion, that is chloride wasting is seen. Okay, so this is what is seen. Now what is type 4? In type 4 there is mutation in Bartter chloride CKB subunit. Okay, now even this is the same protein which is seen, which is similar to type 3, but here there is this here, even this will allow chloride channel to pass through. So this is Bartter chloride and CCLKB subunit. So this is Bartter. So even here you'll have Bartter Cl chloride. Okay, but here there is no there is only mutation in this chloride channel KB, but not the Bartter channel. Here there is complete mutation. So here there is normally Bartter chloride. This is blood. This is lumen. This is lumen, and this is blood. Normally Bartter chloride C chloride channel KB. So this will help in absorption of chloride into the blood. So here whenever there is mutation, there is no absorption of chloride into the blood. The final type is the fifth type 5, which is extracellular calcium sensing receptor, which is called as CASR. So this is present here. So it is a receptor, so I am drawing a receptor 1. So here, this is calcium sensitizing receptor mutation. So whenever there is mutation in calcium sensitizing receptor, then there is decreased, this is lumen, this is blood, decreased calcium absorption, thus leading to hypocalcemia. Okay. So now we have learned about 5 major types of receptors and the 5 major types of mutations that occur in these receptors. So what happens in Bartter syndrome? In Bartter syndrome, or normally in ascending limb of loop of Henle, all these 5 five channels which we have just talked about, all these work in integrated manner. To maintain electrical potential difference and also the sodium gradient. Here, due to in Bartter syndrome, there is mutations of these 5 channels. So because of mutations, there is loss of lumen positive electrical transport. So the positive electrical transport potential is lost. So because of it, there is no sodium chloride magnesium reabsorption and calcium reabsorption, thus leading to sodium chloride wasting and hypercalciuria, leading to hypocalcemia and then mild hypomagnesemia. So these are the things which are seen in thick ascending limb of loop of Henle. All these are seen in thick ascending limb of loop of Henle. Right? So this is what is seen in Bartter syndrome. Now this, the second type of syndrome which I said I will talk about is gitelman syndrome. But before going into gitelman syndrome, we will see what is the clinical features of Bartter syndrome. So here, because of this mutations, first it presents in neonatal or early childhood. So presentation neonatal or early childhood, And then what is the presenting features? It presents with polyuria because there is no absorption, right? Polyuria, polydipsia, and there is sodium chloride wasting, which I have said just now. So because of this sodium chloride wasting, there is salt craving and also growth retardation is seen. If you wanted to know the metabolic abnormalities, as I have said, there is loss of potassium. So because there is loss of potassium, there is hypokalemia, there is hypochloremia. Because the kidney is not able to maintain the acidosis, so there is metabolic alkalosis. And there is decreased concentrating and diluting ability of kidney. There is hypercalciuria because of calcium sensitizing receptor mutation. So hypercalciuria will lead to hypocalcemia, and this also may manifest as nephrocalcinosis, that is stones in the kidney. And because of magnesium, there may be hypomagnesemia. And finally, there is increased urinary prostaglandin excretion. So this is what generally happens in Bartter syndrome. So this increased prostaglandin excretion results in a syndrome which is called as hyperprostaglandin E syndrome. This is mainly seen in severe Bartter syndrome. Here, neonates present with severe volume depletion and failure to thrive. And because of prostaglandin, there is fever, vomiting, and diarrhea. These fever, vomiting, and diarrhea are due to prostaglandin E2 production. Right? And along with it, in antenatal period, the patient has fetal polyuria. So when the fetus has fetal polyuria, then it may cause maternal polyhydramnios. Whenever there is polyhydramnios, it may predispose to premature labor. In type 4, there may be sensory neural deafness. It may be associated with sensory neural deafness. And in type 3, so in type 3, they have a phenotype between, which is intermediate between Bartman's and Gitelman syndrome. I will just tell you about what is Gitelman syndrome. But here you will see in type 3, you will see a phenotype between Bartter's and Gitelman syndrome. Because in both, there is the mutation of chloride channel KB, KB channel. In both, thick ascending limb and DCT respectively. And thus, there is preservation of chloride CKA chloride channel in thick ascending limb. I'll discuss about it at the end of this lecture. but please bear this for a second. Right? And now let us learn about the Gitelman syndrome. What is the pathogenesis and what is the clinical manifestation of Gitelman syndrome? Here, this occurs due to the mutation in thiazide sensitive sodium chloride co-transporter, which is NCCT, in distal convoluted tubule. So what happens? What does this do? So this sodium chloride transporter, so if this is the convoluted tubule, distal convoluted tubule, and this is the one, so here this is DCT and this is lumen, this is bled, it is present on the apical side, and this will help in transport of sodium and chloride. So this leads to sodium chloride co-transporter, NCCT. So what does this normally do? This sodium chloride co-transporter will normally reabsorb sodium and chloride into the cell, into the blood. But if there is mutation in sodium chloride co-transporter, then there is no reabsorption of sodium and chloride, and thus there is sodium and chloride excretion, which leads to hypovolemia. Okay, this is what generally happens. So there is also in Gitelman syndrome, we have seen that there is severe hypomagnesemia. But why is there severe hypomagnesemia? Magnesemia is unknown. Reason is unknown, but we have found that there is severe hypomagnesemia. Now, in both Bartter's and this we have got it, right? So, in Gitelman syndrome, the clinical features include, as I have said, sodium wasting and chloride wasting and also magnesium wasting. So, this is seen, and it is also characterized by neuromuscular symptoms. The neuromuscular symptoms include fatigue, weakness, carpopedal spasms, cramps, and tetany. This is due to hypocalcemia. These are due to hypocalcemia. I mean, hypocalcemia is seen in Gitelman syndrome, but the reason is not known. Now, there is one thing which occurs common in Bartter's and Gitelman syndrome. In Bartter's and Gitelman syndrome, there is loss of sodium and chloride. Loss of sodium and chloride in urine. So along with it, there is polyuria. So there is hypovolemia. So this hypovolemia and this sodium loss, this will activate renin, angiotensin, aldosterone system. So this activation of renin, aldosterone, angiotensin system leads to increased sodium reabsorption by collecting tubule via epithelial sodium channel. So because of decreased sodium, we reabsorb sodium in the collecting duct by epithelial sodium tubules. Right? So whenever there is, as we all know, whenever there is reabsorption of sodium, if this is the collecting duct here there is reabsorption of sodium by epithelial sodium channels. So there is reabsorption of sodium. Sodium will not get reabsorbed alone. So it should take something with it, right? So it leads to the secretion of potassium or hydrogen. So sodium reabsorption will lead to the secretion of potassium and hydrogen ions. So this leads to hypokalemia and metabolic acidosis. Right? So this is what is important here. Why there is metabolic acidosis. Sorry, metabolic alkalosis. Because there is excretion of potassium, H plus ions in the lumen. So because of that, there is alkalosis, that is metabolic alkalosis and hypokalemia. And as I have said, there is one more thing which occurs in Bartter syndrome. We have already said that there is a thing which is called as hyperprostaglandin E syndrome. Why does this occur? This is because in Bartter syndrome, whenever renin angiotensin aldosterone system is activated, this will cause increased cyclooxygenase 2 production. So this leads to increased production of prostaglandins, which is prostaglandin E, which causes hyperprostaglandin E syndrome. Okay, so this is what generally happens in Bartter syndrome. So how do you diagnose Bartter's or gitelman syndrome? So the major differential diagnosis of these both is diuretic abuse. So whenever one uses diuretics, the clinical picture will be, clinical features are similar. And even electrolyte imbalances are also similar. So this can be distinguished by diuretic abuse. It can be distinguished by screening urine for offending agents. And Gitelman and Bartter's can be distinguished by, in Gitelman there is severe hypomagnesemia and there is also severe hypocalciuria, whereas in Bartter syndrome there is mild hypomagnesemia, that is one, and also there is severe hypercalciuria, which leads to nephrocalcinosis and hypocalcemia. Here there is hypocalciuria, so there is hypercalcemia, which causes tetany and carpopedal spasms. I'm sorry, I have said that there is hypocalcemia, right? I'm really sorry for that. Here there is hypercalcemia, resulting in cramps, tetany, all these. Okay, I'm really sorry for that. And what are the treatment options that are available for this? Treatment it needs the syndrome lead needs lifelong therapy with potassium and magnesium supplements. That is one. You can treat alkalosis and others with high doses of spironolactone or amiloride. So by these high doses you can treat hypokalemia, alkalosis and magnesium wasting can be treated. So NSAIDs will reduce polyuria and also wasting in Bartter syndrome, because Bartter syndrome it is associated with hyperprostaglandinemia. Reason: hyperprostaglandin syndrome. So these NSAIDs will inhibit this COX-2 enzyme. So COX-2 enzyme, so that this is used, and then. But this is ineffective in gitelman syndrome. I'm sorry, gitelman syndrome. So these are the major treatment options which are available in gitelman syndrome. There is magnesium hypomagnesemia. So hypomagnesemia. For it, you give magnesium repletion. And this magnesium repletion will also treat hypokalemia. And then you can control muscle weakness. Tetany and metabolic alkalosis. So this is about Gitelman syndrome and Bartter syndrome, which occurs in Gitelman syndrome occurs due to a transporter mutation in distal convoluted tubule, whereas the Bartter syndrome and in Bartter syndrome, it occurs due to the mutation in the transporter in thick ascending limb of loop of Henle. So, thank you guys for watching my lecture. I know this is a completely new topic and I have made myself better with and clear. I tried to make it easier. So thank you guys for watching my lecture. If you have any doubts, please comment it in the comment section. If you feel something is inadequate in this lecture, even then, please comment it in the comment section. Thank you for watching my lectures. Thank you.